So what I'm going to present is some efforts by me and by others on numerical analysis for DFT. So I should mention that I am a mathematician, so I have basically no idea about physics, but I work on algorithms and try to prove theorems about algorithms and develop algorithms. Okay, so what can we and cannot we do as mathematicians? So what we do is we prove theorems about numerical methods and models and things like this. And to do that, we have to exaggerate sources of errors. So we have to pick one particular kind of error and say this is the dominant contribution, even if it might not be actually relevant for applications. But we have to start somewhere. And it also means that we are usually 30 years late. So what I'm going to present is basically stuff that has been worked out in the physical community in the 80s, 90s. The aim of this is to understand rigorously why some methods work, some don't. What can we say about the speed of convergence of methods for respect to certain parameters? What should we do to get better convergence? These kind of things. And based on that, to get new methods and implement them in code. Okay. So the main error control for DFT, of course, you know this even better than I do. There's, of course, the model error, which is that you model your system in a certain way with the Schrödinger equation and so on. This is one source of approximation. Then you choose a particular DFT functional. That's another source. Then you pick a pseudo potential. That's even one more source. And this, as a mathematician, I don't have anything clever to say about it. You know this much better than I do. So what I'm going to focus on, and what most of the mathematical community focuses on, is numerical error, meaning you give me an equation, and I try to solve as best as I can. I try to say what I can about it. So typically, things like Bayes' size, Boolean zone sampling with two L's, quadrature methods, iterative solvers, and so on. Okay, and so what we do as mathematicians mainly falls into three categories. First is theory, to understand the models, are they well posed, does it have a solution, these kind of things. Second, derive error estimates, the error you make by making this particular approximation is this. Third, a posteriori error estimates, which is certify results, which is more what this workshop is about, is saying, here's my error bar for a particular computation. Okay, so I'm going to show three examples of one of theory, one of a priori, one of a posteriori. So this one is about Vanier functions. So I don't have time to explain what Vanier functions are, but of course, most of you know what it is. And there has been a theory of Vanier functions developed. The first to strike were in 2007, which are that Vanier function, well, but actually dates back even further than that. Saying that there exist exponentially localized Vanier functions for topologically trivial insulators. Okay, and a complementary result is that the maximally localized Vanier function procedure, which was devised by Nicolas Martin and David Vanderbilt, actually works to find those. This is for insulators. What we've been working on is try to extend that theory for metals, and what we found is that in theory, yes, you can get almost exponentially localized Vanier function for metals in some sense. But actually, the procedure to find them does not produce exponentially localized Vanier functions. Okay, so we can discuss about that if you're interested. Okay, a second topic would be a priori error bounds, which is here's the error because of a given approximation. So here I'm focusing on Boolean zone sampling and temperature. So I'm assuming that temperature is an artificial parameter and you want the 0k properties. And here we show that for a given number of properties like Fermi level, energy density, ground state density, what you get is you get an error which is the sum of these two terms. So the first term is the fact that you introduce a temperature, sigma is the temperature. You introduce a temperature, so the error goes down as you decrease the temperature. And you also have a k-point sampling, which is this term, where L is the number of k-points in any one direction. And what you find is that this error goes down as L goes to infinity, as expected. But the prefactor depends on the temperature. So of course, this is what you well know, is that as you increase the temperature, it gets easier to converge with respect to the number of k points. Okay, so the point of this study is to understand the performance of the numerical scheme, derive explicit and rigorous error bounds, and also identify the assumptions that are not always made explicit. So in this case, we have explicit assumptions, which are that you have nice structure around the family level, basically. Okay, this is a priori estimate. This is a posteriori error bound. So a posteriori error bound, this is not my work. This is the work of Geneviève, who's over there. And the point here is to be able to say, given a computation, what is the error I make? So I'm assuming here that the only error is due to the fact that you have a finite basis size, so an e-cut, and second, that you don't always converge the SCF cycle to the end. Okay? And what they have been able to show is that the error you make in a certain regime under certain assumptions, which you can check and so on, is given by the sum of two terms, one that depends on k, which is the index of the SCF cycle, basically, and one which is n, which is the e-cut. Okay? And both of those are computable, and you can get things like this plot here, which shows the error in red. This is the actual error as measured, and this is the sum of two terms. The green curve, which is the error due to the SCF cycle, and the black one, which is due to the basis size incompleteness. And using that, you can certify computations to a given error bound. So of course, this is very, very sketchy. What is the problem in these, and why is there hard work to bridge the mathematical results and the physical reality? So the first is that for error bounds that I showed, you get constants, okay? Like this C constant I had in front, which I don't know is some constant, which the analysis tells me is a constant, but I don't really know what it is. And it might be very large, it might be very small, and this is very hard to quantify. So our results are usually applicable in the asymptotic limit in some parameter goes to infinity, which might not be always the case of relevance. And for a posteriori error analysis, the problem is usually getting a computable form for these bounds, which of course there's nothing free, right? You have to work in some way to get these bounds. But there has been some work done in this over the years. Okay, so that was the shameless plug for mathematics as a community and what we can do for DFT and error control. And this is another shameless plug for a code we are trying to develop now, which is at the stage of prototype. So we had there has been several discussions and several comments, like from Nicola Martai commented on the fact that things are too complicated, to paraphrase. And I definitely agree with this, and I think it is definitely hard to get into some of these codes and make relevant quantification to these codes. So what we've been trying to do is to develop a very simple prototype code, and this we're doing now in Julia. So the problem with existing code is that they are too big for what we want to do, which is to get in them and make modifications to the algorithms. And on the other hand, we need simple models to test our predictions and our analysis on. And so usually the way this has been done is that there are mathematicians who work on extremely simple model, trivial model in 1D with no exchange correlations, these kind of things. And on the other hand, professional people like you who do actual computations on very complex code. So this is an attempt to try and bridge those two communities and have a unified way of doing things. We do this in Julia, which is a new language, so it has its flaws, but at least in theory, it should be able to bypass the two-language problem, which is that you code the intensive stuff in Fortran, and then you make interfaces in Python. Julia has the potential to do everything at once, both performant code and productive code. Okay, so we've started this. This is pretty recent. We started this in January. The lead developer is Michael Herbst, who is a postdoc in our lab. He started in January, and now, basically 1 month ago, he had this first demonstration of band structure for silicon at the LDA GTH level. But of course, it's not that hard to go to more professional series, and it's 2,000 lines of code, right? And 2,000 lines of code in Fortran, you can declare a function, more or less. So what we've been trying to do for this is to rely as far as possible on existing infrastructure, so LabXC, we've had talks about that, FFT, linear algebra, EigenSolver, optimization, all these kind of things. There are libraries for that, so we don't really need to implement Poulet or AlloBPCG or these kind of things, right? We can just take it off the shelf, and if it doesn't exist or if it is insufficient for our needs, we can just modify it. Okay, so if you're interested in this kind of effort, contact us. And so as a conclusion, there are numerical analysts working on DFT. It's a small but quite active research area. There are a few groups, so in Paris, where I work, in Berlin, Beijing, UK, and the US. There's also quite a lot of funding activity. So recently, those people who are, two of them are mathematicians, one of them is a computer scientist, and the other is a chemist. They got a big grant to work on this kind of thing, so they expect more activity on that. And there are positions available for people who would be interested in working on this kind of things. Thank you very much.